Hello everyone, welcome back to another SciCraft server tour. It's been over 1 year since we did the last one, when we were touring Mumbo Jumbo and showing him the Witch Farm project. I got a lot of new viewers since then, and some of those might not have seen a server tour before. A quick explanation of what this is. The SciCraft server, there's a group of dedicated people that work together, and every so often we finish a huge project, we do a server tour showcasing the project, and usually invite one guest. And this time we got the wonderful JL2579 that you probably know from the Zipcrowd server as a guest. And the project we want to showcase today is the Creeper Farm project that you might have seen in my StarCraft episodes already partially. Today is the big reveal. As always, Rego, the server founder, will narrate the tour, and I'll be mostly quiet this time.
Today, let me first introduce our guest. We have the one and only, the true, well, you all probably know him. JL2579.
Hey, guys.
Welcome and glad to have you here for this tour.
Thanks. Thanks for letting me join and thanks for showing me this awesome looking room. Like at the beginning, it was almost feeling like not playing Minecraft because these reflections look so realistic. Who built this room, by the way?
Oreo and Panic.
So, yeah, what are we going cool. to? Yeah, where are we going to head to first?
Let me first introduce a few more people. So we have a whole bunch of new members since the last tour, some of which are here. So maybe I start from the left with Process.
There. Hello.
Drove.
Hello.
And I think Helga is also new.
Yeah, hi.
I think everyone else was already in a previous tour. So, yeah, nice big team by now. And, well, you see here this huge map of our server, and by now this is actually a very small map because, yeah, we expanded quite a bit beyond that. And in fact, today's project is not going to be on this map, but we got a little zoom out that's just over there, and you can't see it yet, so there we go. A large creeper perimeter. And you might just be able to see it here in the center where things look a little odd, as if it wouldn't render correctly. But that's actually the farm we're going to visit today. And let me say as much already, it's record-breaking. Literally. All right, I suggest we head over there. It's going to be quite a journey, and we'll meet you at the farm. All right, we finally arrived at our new creeper farm. And yeah, so this is just the nether arrival area, but I guess we'll first take a look at the overworld side. Because this is actually a farm that requires two dimensions to work at full efficiency. And wait, everything's a bit dark in here. And we'll have to fly in.
Take a look back at the
at I don't the see anything. Ah, there we go. Why did you wall in this portal with black concrete?
So, everything a bit creeper themed. The villagers have already left this village because, well, they were a bit afraid of this oversized creeper. But yeah, we got an even bigger one. And of course, everything here is styled in creeper colors. So these huge mini perimeters that you can see here, they are part of the pixel art that you saw in the map room.
And is there white in between?
No, it's just black concrete.
Ah, now I can see it.
But yeah, it looks pretty cool. There is void, however, directly under the farm, so we removed all the bedrock there. Let me quickly land. Show this off, so here we're at Y7, but it goes down quite a bit. So you can see here it's completely void, just so we could build the farm as low as possible and get the absolute maximum out of it. Now, the farm also looks a bit odd, maybe. So, Panic, maybe you want to tell us about the basic principle?
Okay, this is a sidewards acceleration farm, which means that we have portals and spawning spaces next to the portals, and the creepers get shot from the spawning space into the portal sideways. Now you can probably see that there are quite big portals and also portals without frames. This was one of the biggest problems or one of the most time-consuming things building that farm. We had to use different methods to first get the white poles and then also slice them. So we don't have obsidian that could stop the creepers or stop the creeper flying over. We can quickly explain it, I guess.
Yeah, I think how it works. Just now we are actually seeing why we removed the frames to a large extent. And we can see Pikmin dropping here every now and then, since these large portals tend to spawn quite a few Pikmin. And that would take up a lot of the mob caps, so it would reduce the efficiency of the farm.
I have a slight problem. I'm stuck at the floor, and I don't have this plug-in, so which allows me to like easier fly. So I cannot get off without placing some blocks here, which I don't want to.
Oh.
can we?
It's
like,
yeah, even for me, it's difficult to take off, but.
Yeah, I don't know. I can try, but I... Ah, now I got it. Okay. I got it. Okay.
Let's quickly wait for JL to come in. And
yeah, the problem is also I don't see many chunks, so I'm basically flying through void, and I have no idea where the middle is.
Just land somewhere. I can guide you.
I see something. Okay. There's a glass ceiling. Is it below that?
Yeah, below that.
Okay. Got you.
So here the
why do we have the glass ceiling?
The glass ceiling is to prevent lightning strike on top of the farm.
Yeah, so we have a huge glass ceiling up here, which doesn't raise the height map in 112. And in fact, even string on top to prevent skeletons, I guess.
No,
snow layers.
Oh, fair enough. Okay, it's high enough up because an extreme hills biome.
We built this farm in an extreme hills biome because we wanted to also finish the double chest of each item, and we needed emerald ore for that. So we built a giant perimeter in an extreme hills biome and mined emerald ore here.
I think we left off at the portals. There's, of course, one problem with the portals. Even if you get them into this shape, they do emit light, and quite a bit. So it would actually prevent spawning or greatly reduce the spawn rates in the neighboring spawn pads that you can just ever so slightly see here. So you can see here with the trapdoors that make sure only creepers can spawn, because only those can fit underneath. Well, for skeletons and zombies, the head height would be too large, so they don't fit, and any such spawning attempt is cancelled. But yeah, how do we get rid of the light? Well, that's exactly why we have these thick water curtains here, because water just attenuates the light level much faster than it would in normal air. And that way we can still get them reasonably close and shoot them over as quick as possible. But yeah, maybe Panic, you want to tell us, or Rechen, about the slicing and...
Oh yeah, we created those giant portals with a chunk save state. It was, it's fixed by now in the news versions, but it was found by Sky and Earth, and it worked in 112. So if you have too much data or too much books in one chunk, we prevent the chunks from saving. And we basically built every second chunk a portal column, like usual portals. Then we prevented them from saving, removed them, and then in the chunks there in between, we built another row of portals. And you need to think of it like a time rollback. If you unlock those chunks and come back, all the obsidian in between the portals would disappear, and we would only left over with a full column of portals.
Yeah, or you could remove the obsidian and keep the portal the other way around. So
yeah, without updating.
The portals always stopped at a chunk boundary. So maybe I can... what was that? F3 something?
F3G?
NG.
If you have the chunk boundaries, so you would have a portal that has, for example, the frame here. The portal blocks all over here for the entire chunk, and then the other side of the frame in the next chunk. And by basically suppressing the side chunks, Well, the portal frame would be gone once you come back, but the portal blocks would still be there.
Yeah, and then once we have those white portals, we actually only got those white portals, so the slicing will be easier later. So we had a top row of portals and a bottom row, and now we want to get rid of all the obsidian. And it would take really long to use normal update suppression to remove each and every obsidian block. So we use a technique called portal slicing, which was found by Kaylee, where you send the updates, use update suppression. So overload the game, basically, so it stops updating more stuff. And you send updates through that column first, then update suppress, and therefore all the other blocks stay, but you basically remove a whole row of, or a whole column of portals. And then you could, you basically have the obsidian detached from the portal itself, and you could just mine it normally. So there's a 3-byte gap here. We removed the slice of portals just below the obsidian and the one just above the obsidian, and then we could just mine the obsidian normally, which was way faster than doing it the other way around.
Yeah, so here in the middle of this empty strip, there was the obsidian, and as Pen explained, above and below, there was also a row of portal blocks. Those we actually allowed to get removed, but that way, when we removed the obsidian, it wouldn't affect the other portal blocks anymore, and they would just stay behind. So basically, overloading the game twice allowed us to make these huge portals without frames.
Okay, should we maybe take a look at the roof of the farm?
Yep.
It's also something important. So you might know that portal lag, well, in 1.15 it's fixed, but in 1.12, which we are currently playing, is still very prominent. And you can't just shoot millions of creepers through a portal, right? You can't, it's literally unplayable then. So what we do here is we portal cache the portals using items before. So portal location from the overworld to the nether is 8 to 1. So 8 blocks in the overworld go to 1 in the nether, of course. So every 8th block, we throw an item through every 15 seconds. And that way, this portal location basically keeps getting cached, and the creepers themselves that spawn randomly don't have to load the portals or the portal locations again. And that's what you see up here. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
That's basically how we keep the server performance up, so it can run at 20 TPS. Otherwise, basically, every time creeper spawns in the portal would not be cached, which happens quite frequently, that some part of the portal is not properly cached, it would have to search for the corresponding destination in the nether, and that just takes forever. So we make sure that everything here is properly being cached, so the game remembers the position where it needs to go to, and that speeds up things by a lot and allows us to run this farm at a reasonable pace.
Can we turn it on?
Yep, that's the first thing that needs to be done.
Oh yeah.
Takes a couple minutes until all the portals are cached.
I will go to the nether and prepare the portals there and place a bot, I guess.
Yep.
Oh no, there's already a bot. It's
already there, yeah.
And are the portals in the correct state? Oh no, they aren't.
I can check. I have my second account there.
Well, if you have your second account there, just flick this lever. But let me go through the portal first, okay? Then I'm in the overworld again.
Yeah. You're there?
Yeah. Oh, the lever with the lamp, right? At the bottom portal is off.
Okay, we can start the portal caching then.
Regu, we are in the center as the lever. Do you want to flick it?
Sure. Oops. That's what I wanted.
So here we are in the AFK spot of the farm. It's marked with this diamond block here, and we have two levers. This one here will activate the portal caching. We are ready to turn it on now.
Yeah.
And the second one here would activate the spawning pads. But yeah, we firstly want to charge the farm so we wouldn't get any lag.
Yeah. All right.
So this will now lag the game for like a minute, and afterwards it runs fine even with creepers.
Also, we cache the portals not with gunpowder, we cache them with cobblestone. I will explain later why we use cobblestone, and we quickly turn on the cobblestone generator So we need over 100,000 items per hour only to cache all the portals in this farm.
Yeah, so that's way more than most normal farms would produce. And we just use that as an auxiliary item that is sort of being consumed and thrown away afterwards. So yeah, that's a pretty cool cobblestone generator. I think it's fairly simple and just produces a ton of cobblestone.
What the heck? I overlooked that.
Don't die on us.
Oh, I managed to get out.
It's a bit of a dangerous place. But yeah, so we have the lava columns. As soon as they flow out, they turn into cobblestone, and then we just have some TNT dropping down in the middle, exploding somewhere near the bottom, and stuff dropping. And of course, blast resistance is reduced by shifting things in the right point of time.
And that's a very minimal design with the endstone there. I like it.
This glass would break from the TNT.
I know, but it's interesting. Oh, wait, the water columns actually prevent the other glass rows.
Yeah, they shield the rest.
Shielded. It's an interesting pattern.
Yep.
Okay, portal caching is almost done. I guess we first look up
stairs. Oops.
Yeah, I think it's best to go in spectator now and look through the or next to the portals along the farm. Then you can see the creepers. I'll start them in
It's still stuttering a little bit server side. Yeah. Like the minecarts are moving a bit slow.
It's not finished completely.
Yeah. So that's exactly, as you can see, the server's not running at 20 TPS while it's starting to cache, but once it's ready, it will pick back up. So yeah, these chest minecarts, they just go around, distribute a few items into each hopper here, into a dropper below, and these, well, they basically dispense against this fence gate, such that it ends up in the portal below. And as Penny explained, every 8 blocks with one of these contraptions, just to make sure everything stays nicely cached, and then this caches for the entire column here, or actually an 8 wide column.
Okay, portals are cached. I'm turning on the creepers. This is another quick initial lag, and then we see the creepers flying through. Creepers are on.
So now it's turned on. As you can see, the trapdoors here retracted, so now the spawning pads are actually free, and creepers can spawn here every once in a while. And we can already see them being shot to the side, ending up in the portal, so they are gone in a very short lifetime. And yeah, that way they immediately free the mobcap in the overworld and just end up in the Nether, where we can process them further.
Yeah, now the farm is completely running. Not laggy at all. Right.
If you want, I give you some numbers. So the creeper by its own has a lifetime by 8 game ticks. And yeah, the farm will produce about 450k power on, if it runs on full power with 2 mob caps. But on a single mob cap, like right now, we are on 420k power. Only creepers.
Okay, but so it's only barely limited by the mob cap, right? It's
it's extremely
efficient in terms of removing them from the mob cap with just about half a second of lifetime.
I mean, the death animation in the usual, for example, Don't Excel mob farm is about only 2 seconds for only the death animation that blocks the mob cap, and we get rid of all that stuff here. That's why it's so efficient.
It's amazing.
Yeah, so we shorten it by over a factor of 5, I guess. In total, I'm not sure how long the down excel takes to fall down, probably also like half a second at least.
So now, if you want to use Spectator to teleport to my second account, then you can see them landing in the Nether. I mean, this is the better side, right? The creepers die.
So let's immediately go to Panic's second account, since we're already in Spectator. And yeah, so we started over here in this tunnel. So now we're here in the collection area or processing area, and that is a sight to behold. And I turned down my mob sounds to an absolute minimum, so this is not blasting your ears, but just being in here, it's insane.
Oh my god.
I'm in the thing, I can't get out.
Spectator mode, clash C.
Yeah, we could show this on survival, but it's actually safe to be in here because creepers die instantly from the fall damage, so they won't blow up on you. Actually, someone is already in. Yeah, they're just taking a bit of damage from the magma blocks here, which are actually not really needed, but we just kept them from another design. But apart from the little damage from the magma blocks, it's perfectly safe in here. It's a slight shifting floor to collect the items, just to move things around and have different heights of blocks here. So they're always being pushed a bit further to the center. And yeah, eventually collected here in one block. So using hoppers or hopper minecarts underneath just wouldn't be feasible. It would be way too much effort, just because the rates are so insanely high.
Storage at the moment, the portal's not on.
Oh yeah, inflict a lever again.
Why are is the creeper density not equal? Like, most of them spawn at the corners.
Because the portals at the top are actually not big enough, so it doesn't cover the whole farm. But it's enough so the outside portals cache to those portals.
Ah, yeah. Makes sense.
Yeah.
Yeah, they connect to one that's already existing.
If you look at the bottom, the big gray pattern, the big gray square, that's the size of the creeper farm in the overworld.
Where is it?
At the bottom, in the floor.
The floor. So that's the nether equivalent of the farm size.
Exactly.
We would need portals. Well, of course, the farm itself is round, so we optimized it for the exact spawning range. Or spawning and despawning range, in case they get shot to the outside. But yeah, that's about the area. You have to imagine that thing times 8 in every direction. Is the size.
What is this long TNT chain doing?
We come to that in a second.
Explain it later.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I guess we can start with that. Right now, there are 420,000 creepers dying, which would yield 420,000 gunpowder per hour, right? Mm-hmm. But it would be nice to also use looting on that, so you get over 1,000,000 gunpowder per hour. And that's why we have different modes for that farm, and I suggest we turn the farm as it is off and turn the other mode on, but we should probably cut the video for that.
Yep, it will take a bit to reconfigure. All right, so we had to reconfigure a few things for the next mode of the farm. Maybe Panic, you want to explain to us what has been happening?
Okay, so first we had the portals cached to the fall damage version above us. But now we want to use the second mode. And for that we need to cache the portals to that small one in here. So we did that now, and now we can start up the second mode. Rechenmaschine has to do some configuration again. But I guess you can watch that.
What's dropping here in the portal, it's just a cobblestone from the caching that's constantly coming in. Okay, Rechen, please.
Yeah, so all the portals from the overworld, from the creeper farm, are cached to the portal at the bottom. And we want to kill the creepers with TNT. And the reason for that is that we can use actually looting on TNT. So I will turn this little system. We have an arrow holding chamber here, and we will ignite the TNT with this flaming arrow. This arrow, I need to shoot another one. This one isn't perfect. It needs to be in a pixel accurate location, otherwise it would despawn after a few minutes. And you can see it now the arrow is moving, that means he won't despawn. So if you go to the AFK spot at the bottom, we can start the system.
Yeah, so we have to go all the way back to this tunnel. And the arrow just stays alive because it's constantly being moved. And it's just so far on the side of the piston that it would ignite the TNT block when it gets pushed next to it. But now we need to be all in this very end chunk here. I hope everyone's over there.
I'm here. Yeah.
It's important that no one is loading the front chunks without with a survival player.
Yeah, otherwise we would have mob cramming and similar things.
The whole system is a lazy looting setup, so the mobs are actually in the lazy chunks, so they don't cause much lag. And then basically when they are killed, they come back to the loaded chunks, so the items can be loaded. So it's just at the edge of our loaded chunks right now.
So you see here a very simple clock that every couple seconds.
How do you make sure that they come back when they are killed? Like, does the explosion launch them back into a non-lazy chunk? Or
there's
a lazy chunk. It's like at the border. I can explain it. It's But yeah, we should just look at it, I guess.
Can we all go over there now?
Yes.
We have to use spectator mode. And, so okay. We enable the target feature that
spectator
prevents us from loading chunks as spectators. Mm-hmm. So we have a bot here that gets a TNT dispensed or disposed every couple of seconds, which is then placed and pushed along this conveyor. And that way, of course, at the very end, one TNT is being
still somehow loaded.
Yeah, someone is loaded.
I think the nether bot is the problem.
Oh yeah, true. Yeah, we have to go back again real quick.
Okay.
It just doesn't load chunks, but the chunks are still loaded, right?
Yeah. So this is a bit key.
Okay, now almost everyone should be here. Process.
Everyone go to this one chunk.
Yeah, now we can go forward.
Okay.
Let's go ahead, just want to make sure things are properly unloaded.
Why is the TNT timing rather slow? Does it make it somehow more efficient?
We place a TNT every 98 game ticks, and the mobs, they are like frozen in the lazy chunks. They don't get ticked. They don't do anything. So it doesn't really matter how often we kill them. I mean, you need to kill them every few seconds because they drop quite a lot of gunpowder and you want to get rid of that because of lag. So yeah, we figured out
just
that.
Just reducing the rate of TNT usage, I guess.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yeah. Okay, should we turn the creepers on? Okay.
Fire them up.
And there they...
I think we could turn on the portal first. No?
Portal is on. Everything is linked correctly
there
now.
Okay, yeah, for me the portal doesn't render.
Now it looks a bit glitchy because we are basically looking at chunks that are not loaded, right?
Just at the edge of being loaded. So yeah, things are quite funky here. And everything looks a bit out of place, but that's really just an artifact of the chunk being lazy. So if you look out a bit, oh gosh, this is laggy on the client, you can see that just slightly behind this stuff stops existing because we're not loading chunks, so we're just using the carpet feature here for the showcase. It's not needed for the farm, it works in pure vanilla. But of course in vanilla you couldn't look at it, so we couldn't demonstrate it here.
And now, since the TNT has Rechenmaschine's playout data on it from the arrow, he kills the creepers with his looting sword in his hand, which means we get the 2.5 times multiplier on top of the already 420,000 creeper kills per hour. That way we produce over 1 million gunpowder per hour.
Yeah, it's pretty insane. So you can see creepers just coming out of the portal and things being pushed over here. So do we actually need to reignite the portal every time, I guess?
Yeah, it's important that they all connect to this unlit portal, that they are spawned like in a portal without frames.
Mm-hmm. So that's why there's no portal inside.
Exactly, as otherwise you couldn't push them out.
So yeah, for another bucket we can remove the portal and there's a way to automatically ignite it again, I guess. Up here, yeah, just with some flint and steel. So every now and then we need to refill it. And
okay, so we can now take a look at all the items coming in the overworld. This is where we collect them.
And so you can see the server is having a really easy time. It's 30 milliseconds per tick, so still far away from the 50 millisecond limit.
Doing I guess you can use spectate again to teleport to the creeper.
Yeah. Okay, so just to show you guys around a bit better, we're going to use that one again. So going back to the bot that causes the spawning. So this could just be a regular player. We're just using a bot here, so no one of us needs to stay behind. And
where are the items?
Where do we need to go exactly?
You need to wait a bit for that unless I get unloaded and everything. I'll be prepared. So go to this one portal in the overworld, right? Where the item's coming out.
So the one at the...
the southwest corner.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just gonna fly there. Alright, everyone there?
Yep.
Alright, so we arrived at the portal. Yeah, just at the edge of the farm where things are popping out all the time. Here you can see a couple stone from the cobble generator coming in and being put into minecarts. But here we should see every couple seconds now items popping out.
I think someone is loading the nether at the moment.
Yeah, please leaving nether.
We got some issues figured out. Just some chunk loading issues. You can see here every couple seconds there's a ton of gunpowder coming in. So let's quickly step in and see how much that is. Well, it fills your inventory each and every time. So I can try to get rid of all of that. Nah, doesn't quite work. Shouldn't that... No, that way. Okay, so if I stand in here again, plop. And a lot of stuff actually whizzes by. So let's drop all of that. So yeah, that's already a pretty insane amount. So we package it up here using a ton of item sorters. Of course, we need to get rid of the cobblestone. And you can see it's a quite impressive long line going all the way around here. Okay, the rest is just to pick up things that don't get caught so they get a second chance. Yeah, so Rechen, how many item fillers are these?
I think we have 64 double speed shulker box fillers.
64, so a stack of double speed fillers, which means how many items per second are being stuffed into shulker boxes?
Well, it's over 1.1 million power, yeah.
So yeah, that's a pretty insane array.
Guys, you know how absolutely ridiculous this is.
Yeah?
Hey, you started with mob farming, we finished it.
There will never be an end to this, but oh my goodness. I think, at which point is there too much gunpowder? Is there even such a thing? Not for you.
I think the limit is not reached. I think you can make the farm denser and maybe 20 to 30% more efficient.
Hmm.
But yeah, I think it's enough now.
Yeah, for quite a while. All right, the farm, however, has another mode, and maybe you should quickly turn that on. I guess for that, we should go back to the nether for a second and just show you what we're doing there. All right, so we're ready to do the final part of the reconfiguration. We again have to be in spectator so we don't mess up things for Rechen. We'll play the bait here. And yeah, Rechen, take it away.
Yeah, so last time we used an arrow shot by me as a player to get a looting effect from my looting sword on the creepers, but yeah, now we going to use a skeleton. And yeah, the reason for that is, I mean, everyone I think knows it, if a skeleton kills a creeper, you get quite a lot of records. So yeah, let's capture an arrow from the skeleton here.
Okay, so you need a couple arrows. What's the reason for that?
It's a bit difficult to hit this spot at the piston. It's a pixel accurate spot what you need to hit, and we're just multiplying the chunks if you use the few more arrows. We will see if it works the first try. So yeah, we'll send them over now.
Okay, so we have a flying machine that picks up the arrows, loses a couple along the way, doesn't matter.
So oh, that's just client side.
Ah, okay. So yeah, now hopefully one of them at least is in the right place.
Yep, we can see it. All the moving arrows there, they will stay, and a few of them are not moving. They would despawn after a few minutes.
Okay, so the lava ignited them, so they can set off the TNT, and just in the same way as before, they would blow up the creepers. And let's see them coming in.
Yeah,
now we think we have to fly back again.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
To unload this area.
Ah, right.
Oh, is it already? So, for me? I don't know.
No, we have to fly
into the... Fly back.
Just to the FK.
Also with all the spectators.
Yeah.
So it can unload.
A few chunks are always loaded somehow.
Because again, it has to be a lazy chunk. And only once that's there. Yeah, so we use the same thing again with the TNT, but the player placing the TNT doesn't matter at all. It's really just to get the TNT in place as a block. Okay, should we be ready?
Tell me when it's ready, then I can turn on.
No, it's ready.
Okay, then I'm turning on the creepers again. And now the game might be pretty laggy. Because, well, records are unstackable.
And they try to stack nonetheless. So you can see the server is now actually having a bit of a hard time. But I guess we can fly there and spectator again, right?
Yeah.
It should be safe. So let's see what's happening at the front end. And
I'll fly close.
Yeah, so you can see my frames are already getting a bit choppy. It's just because there's such an insane amount of items. And there you see a lot of discs flying out, and holy heck. That is insane.
If you activate F3 plus B, you can actually see the amount of discs, otherwise you can't really comprehend it.
Yeah, so can someone tell us some numbers about how many discs that are being produced here?
Yeah, we get per creeper one record, right? And since we have 420,000 per hour, you get 420,000 records. The bad thing about records, obviously, is that they are not stacking. Like the gun porter would stack, so you can divide the number of entities by 60. And yeah, you can see the server have a bad time now.
Yeah, so that's really just due to the large amount of items or individual stacks that still try to stack. And well, that's pretty insane. And, yeah, you can see client side, they glitch through, but they actually go through the portal. Do we have someone on the Overworld to
teleport? Yes, my main account.
Okay, so yeah, we're just going to use here the spectator again to get around the place and show you guys what's happening, since otherwise a lot of these things is very abstract. And well, here we have the portal where everything's arriving. Of course, it fills your inventory instantly, but we need to come up with a way to store all of this stuff, because seriously, if they don't stack, how many shulker boxes would it fill?
It's double hopper speed of full shulker boxes. So it's 4,000 shulker boxes.
Per hour.
Oh, wait.
No, it's
18,000 shulker boxes per hour.
Yeah, that is pretty insane. So we had to come up with something really smart and surprisingly compact to deal with this. Yeah, this really requires you to know all the ins and outs, really to know every block from every angle. And of course, you know, carpet mod is very helpful there to also learn more about the game. And that really gave us the inspiration to find a solution to this. So with carpet mod, we can rotate blocks easily with the cactus feature. And that was absolutely a key aspect. So I present to you the most compact storage for that many records, a cactus. Retrieval speed might be a bit slow or impossible, but it handles 400,000 records per hour. So in that sense, yeah, the farm for sure is record breaking. Right.
Yeah. Should we take a look at where the items actually go after they are in shulker boxes?
Oh yeah. So if we don't farm records and, well, break them, of course you've already seen the gunpowder gets sorted here into shulker boxes, and well, let's take a look where these are going, because we still got some more. So they end up here in this water stream once they are broken. You can see them down here, basically the droppers spitting them out. So here they get filled. Maybe we can see actually the speed. Oh no, we're not producing gunpowder right now, so probably won't see them being filled. But yeah, this would run at double hopper speed to fill them. So they have two hoppers pointing into them. Or is that actually two? Yeah, should be, right? Yeah, so here the dropper puts stuff in. And probably there's another way. Oh yeah, the dropper runs at double hopper speed. So these two feed into the dropper and that one just runs at twice the speed. So that stuff gets filled and it ends up in this portal. And yeah, wherever this leads, we'll see on the other side, I guess. So back to the Nether we go.
Who's in the Nether?
I am with my second account. I'm not sure. I'm
in the teleport to me as well. I'm standing at a small dropper line.
You can just use the TNT bot to go to. All right, so let's go to the processing part. Again, since things are running, we can't load additional chunks here. So we need to be a bit careful.
Oh, it's off. The farm is off. Don't worry.
Okay, now it's off, so...
Only the caching is on.
We can go back. I'm just going to stay in spectator to show things a bit more easily. So this is where we send items to the overworld, but also where they are coming back. In that case, they fly out to the opposite side and the ready-made shulker boxes end up here. And yeah, then someone want to explain where things are being sent to? Or actually, what's the chest here for?
This is just the intermediate storage and afterwards...
Oh, that's the temp storage. We store a million items there. And if this fills up, we send them back to the overworld to the final storage of all the gunpowder and sand.
All right, and I guess the final storage is then somewhere down this line here.
Along the dropper line, yes. Here there are also the two lines coming together. So the whole project is basically, we want to get a lot of TNT, right? Who needs gunpowder? TNT is the important point. So we also have the sand dupers from the overworld that dupe into the Nether and then dupe again to the overworld. And so we get a lot of sand in the overworld at spawn. And from there, we have dropper line systems, putting them into the Nether, and then also dropping them over here. So here, the gunpowder and the sand come together and get shot through a portal again into the overworld again, where we have a crafting system for TNT. So I suggest we take a look at that next.
We can go through this portal. Just don't update it.
That one... sorry, that's the wrong state. That way. Okay. That one should be easier to visit. So now we just have to watch out for a next one, I guess.
Ooh. It's spawn-proof, all is spawn-proof.
Ah, nice. Alright, so we ended up a bit in a strange location here since we used that modified portal. Again, update suppression and similar things are being used. And what do we have here? Question mind to...
So we have here a big storage for sand and a big storage for gunpowder. Just use gravel here because they are not gunpowder blocks. Anyway, we have for sand and gunpowder each time a storage of 80 million for 80 million items. And it was also quite a challenge to detect how full those boxes are, or the bulk storage is, and how we detect this amount. I did a little trick and detected the amount of it indirectly. So every time we're sending a full shulker box into this bulk storage, we're sending a single item into this dropper tower. So one item in this tower or in this item silo here represents one shulker box in the system here. Because of the items are stacking, it's way more compact and smaller. And we can indirectly see the fill level of the big bulk behind it.
Okay, so if there's a stack of endstone, that means 64 shulker boxes filled with either sand or gunpowder.
Exactly.
The main storage behind it. And you can imagine all of these chests here already filled, so that's quite a lot.
Yep. Every time we put a shulker box in, we put one item into the front chest here. And if you would take one item out, you would take the item out of the chest again.
And it's a single item detection. Or stack?
Yeah, so can we actually see shulker box. Boxes in here? Oh yeah, there we go.
Yeah, there are a lot of shulkers.
So they're in the back columns first. I guess it first fills up the back columns and then goes to the front?
No, it's actually the front first, but it also took the items from the front first if you craft it. So the items in the back were a bit protected because I didn't craft all of it.
It was basically filled up to the brim and we already used up a lot. That's also why the indicator is not completely filled. But yeah, that's a pretty large indicator given that it's always double chests plus hoppers. All right, and so everything here goes into a crafting system, right?
Yeah, this is the part here in the middle. Player would stand here. Rechen, do you want to stand in?
Maybe? Oh, should I craft? I can turn on the system.
The player would stand here in the middle, and here on the outside we have shulker box unloaders for gunpowder and for sand, and the amount of unloaders basically balances the sand and gunpowder. And then this, all the sand and gunpowder would just arrive in the middle where a player would stand, and he can use that one crafting table here to craft millions and millions of TNT.
Yeah, so of course this needs some fast crafting features on the client. Well, that's just to ease the very repetitive part a bit. But yeah, even with that, Rechen has a hard time keeping up, it seems.
Yeah, it's about 700k per hour. What you can craft.
Yeah, so that's an insane amount of TNT coming out of there.
Then behind we have the TNT shulker fillers again for the TNT storage. You can even stand in the TNT stream now.
Yeah, so sometimes you have other items dropping in, so you need the item sorter, I guess.
Just some sand, because at the beginning you kind of get a bit more of sand because the gunpowder dropper line is a bit longer than the sand one.
Yeah, since because you need more gunpowder in total, it just...
Exactly, just at the beginning.
So we can just quickly drop that out and let it despawn. Actually, it's sandstone now. But yeah, you can see my inventory is filling up rather quickly if I actually stand out here. Now it doesn't seem like I'm picking up a lot.
Items sometimes pass your client. You have to move around.
Okay, and now when I just slightly move, it's instantly filled.
Yeah, so the whole project basically consists out of the creeper farm, then connected the sand tuples and the crafting system here. And we can run the sand tuples and the creeper farm together, and then every evening or so, just stand here, craft all the TNT from the day, or craft all the gunpowder from the day into TNT in like half an hour or an hour or so. And that way, yeah, we can basically have the farms running 24/7 and get all the TNT out.
And so what storage do we have for TNT here?
Right now, just the storage, yeah. We will build a nice one later.
It's for like 8 million items, I guess.
Yeah, can look in here. Should be filled a lot.
Casual 8 million, I mean, what's that?
Yeah, we plan to actually get a billion TNT, but since we will probably update sooner or later and parts of this whole system won't work anymore, mainly the chunk loading system in the Nether, we will probably reduce that number by quite a bit. Maybe go for 100 million TNT or even less.
And why are we doing this?
Because we hope that at some point movable tile entities will be added to the game, and then we can ditch our TNT duping machines and use dispensers, legit TNT for perimeter making.
I mean, it's really no problem. The amount of TNT is easy. Just need to move a bit on entities, that's hard.
Yeah, and so in principle, most of the parts of this farm would still work in higher versions. It's really just the chunk loading that... Yeah, modding kind of improved, but also messed up. It It's a bit ambiguous. It's of course nice to have less issues. Oh yeah, the height map. Well, it wouldn't matter so much anymore, apart from the glass roof.
Yeah, we can just we build the glass roof a bit lower so we can use TNT to just destroy it if we need to get rid of it. So it's not at build limit.
Yeah. Well, we might have a bit of TNT to spare for that. Tiny bit. All right. I think that's pretty much all for today's episode. So, any last words?
TNT go boom, yes.
Yeah, that's a good thing. So, yeah, we hope you guys had a blast with this tour. And we hope to see you again soon for another one. So, till then, take care. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.